Hey, good morning, everybody.
Happy Wednesday morning.
Cara, I even forgot to ask if you even had a cup of coffee with you this morning.
I've already drank my coffee this morning, so I'm good to go.
Well, Mark's worried about you in the chat there. He's he's concerned. Yeah. It's good. We are a loving and giving and caring community of people here. That's for sure.
If nothing else, we are that.
Hey, welcome everybody. Yeah. Let's dwell on the mugs a little bit because that kind of gives us a little bit of a bridge here. Mark's in there with a little thing. Zoom in. Happy anniversary. First off, Brent, happy anniversary.
Oh, hey. Yes, happy anniversary to you, too. I wish I could reach out and give you a big hug or something.
Yeah, no kidding. Digital hug. Love. Some distance. Someday we'll have robots that can fill that gap for us.
I don't even want to think about that. Let's move along.
Okay, then. All right. I guess I touched a nerve there.
Made me feel really uncomfortable right there, Chris.
That's right. Yeah. Yeesh. And thanks. It's an anniversary for us, but we're awfully proud of the fact and pleased with the fact that so many folks do like to hang out with us on Wednesday mornings. I look at the things like, you know, that we have like 130 some people, 136, I think it was yesterday, people who are, you know, registered followers in Crowdcast. That blows my mind. I thought we'd have 5 or 10 people, you know, at the most ever. We have some events that are popping up to, you know, 60 registrations, for some Wednesdays too. So I said this to my wife the other day. I said, I can't believe that all these people want to like listen to us. That's just crazy. Don't they know this by now? Haven't they figured this out? Come on. Anyway,
it's all good, but that's why it's really not us, Chris. It's our
exactly.
wonderful guests. It like the beautiful and lovely Cara North. Welcome. Thanks for hanging out with us today.
Yes.
Of course. I'm glad to come back, guys.
Yes. And Cara is here because she was actually our first guest. Brent and I did a bunch of episodes early on just to sort of get into the swing, just the two of us kind of get some of the groove down. And then Cara joined us for the very first one. In celebration, for those of you who are in the chat and such, in celebration of today's 1 year anniversary, we will, at the end of today's session, be pulling a random draw to give away two of these beautiful idiotic mugs. So stick around at the end of it. We're going to do a random draw from all the people who are here today, and we'll send two lucky contestants will receive a free idiotic mug. So anyway, that's because we've had lots of chat in the last few weeks too about mugs and stuff since we got them. You know, clearly there's jealousy abounding. So
clearly
share the love. Anyway,
let's pack them really really good though, because one of mine has a chip in it, so I'm down to one.
Well, that was the one we dropped. That was us. That wasn't packing.
Oh, yeah.
That
was us. We just decided to send that broken one to you. Pay the extra freight. Oh, well, anyways, let's jump into the topic we were supposed to talk about. I know everybody is super psyched about our anniversary, but what they really want to talk about is instructional design stuff, because that is what gathers us here every Wednesday. So... The first time that Cara was on, she talked about that often perfect mesh, but often uncomfortable mesh and very different mesh between instructional design in academics and instructional design in the workplace, in business. And we had a fantastic conversation. And unfortunately, it was so early on, there probably weren't that many people listening to us. So it'd be fun to kind of... cap that a little bit and just address that topic again, because I think it's important. I mean, I think a lot of people really don't see it or have the experiences that we do, having had a foot in each world. It seems pretty common to us, but maybe Cara, you could just help explain it to us a little bit.
Sure. Do you want me to introduce myself first?
Well, sure.
Okay. Okay. Hi. I'm Cara North. I am a learning experience designer at The Ohio State University. My current title is I'm interim director of academic technology for the College of Education and Human Ecology. So I will be leading our group for about a month, month and a half while my boss is out on medical leave. But yeah, I've been doing this. This is year 11 for me, which blows my mind that I've been doing it for that long, but I've worked in different companies and a couple of nonprofits. I've kind of ran the gamut of experience. I've been a learning management systems administrator. I've been a curriculum developer. I've been a stand-up trainer, been an instructional designer. So any hat that you can kind of wear in L&D, I've wore it at least briefly throughout this time. Also in my spare time, I'm a PhD student here at Ohio State. I'm a third year, so I'm wrapping up my coursework in the next year, year and a half in learning technology. So hopefully I'll be done with that maybe by late 2020, early 2021. Kind of depends on how quickly I can get things moving, but pretty busy person, but I like it that way.
Yeah, you were telling us about, I think it was your transition that you've done some time. Your corporate time was spent a little bit at Amazon. And I think you were working with a product rollout, some training around that, and then you were and then you went over into the academic side of things, and then that's where sort of you started to recognize and see the uniqueness between the two.
Yeah, definitely. And it's really interesting because I went back last night and just briefly listened to our first conversation just to make sure I could remember what we talked about. It was really funny because there's a little bit of foreshadowing in that conversation, because at that time I was being recruited for the role I'm currently in here at the university. So my first few years working here at the university, I worked in a research center that works with different companies to do job task analysis, assessment work, that kind of stuff. But I didn't actually get my pure, when you think of an academic instructional designer, I didn't actually move into that role until July of last year. So I've been over here for less than a year in that role. And yeah, it's a little bit different. I think some of the big things, just brief overview, and then we can unpack it. But a couple things is that for corporate, it's very clear cut. What is the purpose of training, at least in my mind? So if somebody comes with a training request, you can determine if that's needed pretty quickly. You can determine, you know, is this just something that somebody needs to get better feedback on, and that feedback, will that correct the problem? Or do you need to build out like a full training program on how to build a widget? It's very performance based. Whereas here in higher ed, it's kind of the wild, wild west. So I might get a request about working on a course, and maybe it's something that I'm like, well, what kind of skills are a student's going to get out of this particular course? And I don't see it. And the instructor is just so passionate maybe about the topic that I try to encourage them. Okay, what kind of transferable skills are students going to get out of that this course? Is it going to help them in a new course? Is it going to help them in a particular career path? So that's kind of been a newer thing that I think I've brought to this role, is focusing more on those competencies of performance that I don't think a lot of my colleagues have thought about it, just because they didn't have that corporate experience. Because a higher ed ID, in my opinion, is somebody that's very rich in the pedagogy. They understand learning theory like the back of their hand. And there, I have a lot of great colleagues that are very, very into these learning theories, which is wonderful. But for me, when they start talking about it, I just keep going back, okay, so what? So what? So what? What are they going to get out of it? What does that look like? So it's really made, I think, overall a really nice environment for us to collaborate and bounce ideas off of. And I'm really lucky to work with great people that are interested in that perspective.
Very cool. And what kind of a reaction do you often, or more, is there a typical reaction then when you try to sort of bring that other, you know, active aspect of things to the equation?
Great question. When I speak with faculty in particular, you can tell it's just something they hadn't thought of. And it's not anything like ill intention. They have a passion about their topic. And you want to talk about an ultimate SME, you think about a faculty member, right? Because, I mean, they are in it. They love it. They read. They research. I mean, they know everything it is to know about that topic. But as I know, as a PhD student, as a lot of people know going through programs, in a PhD program, they don't teach people how to teach. So a lot of people that go into a PhD, they want to become a professor, but they're not given any tools to learn how to teach. So again, partnership, really focusing on, listen, I know you're the content expert, just like you would in corporate, right? That you focus, like, you're the subject matter expert. I'm the process expert. We're going to make this to where it's sustainable. We're going to make it where it's measurable. Focusing on that has really been successful for me for the most part in doing that, because they really do want it to have, they wanted to have some jazz to it. And one professor in particular that I can think of, she told me, she said, I want the best online course you can make me. And I said, let's do it. So really focusing on the quality level as well is something that really excites me working with faculty.
Well, that's very cool, because you could have anticipated, you know, resistance because of the, you know, the breadth of expertise. I don't know, the traditions of the academic world, you know, university courses and those sorts of things. So that's really awesome, actually, that there's, you know, you're getting that kind of a response and a recognition. That's really cool.
Now, again, I know that's not everybody, right?
I'm sure there's a lot of people in your role that may even be in the chat at other universities going, my instructors really aren't that nice to me. But I think the thing that that I look back to when I look back on my school experience, my higher ed experiences, is that they're just it's just the nature of the beast, right? There's like work has the work right there. So then the performance is really important. And so you can gauge whether or not people know it. When you're in a higher ed setting, even if you're teaching something that does have a very practical, applicable component to it, you're in the academic environment, not in that work environment. So you end up needing to simulate a lot of what somebody might be doing on the job in order to make that application part happen. And then on the other side of it, from a content perspective, just a lot of the courses within higher ed are strictly just knowledge drops, right? Like if you're going to take like the survey classes, right? Like a survey of jazz history, or you dropped the word jazz and that class came into my head, because I can remember the test was, I'm going to say it, back in the day, I know that doesn't apply here, but so we had records, right? Does everybody remember the 33? I know Chris does. So there was this big pack of jazz history. Oh, he's got the 45 right at the ready. Unbelievable.
I'm working from home today.
I think that deserves a little something extra. Oops, except I had the volume down. I remember, so the test was, he would put the record on. Everybody had to buy, well, we all kind of pirated the cassette tapes versions of it. This big, giant, like 12 record set of all like jazz standards and classics. And the exam was, he would put one of the records on and then he would just sort of drop the needle. And we had to name the song and the composer. And I mean, that was not easy. If you're like a student just wanting to learn jazz, I thought that was kind of mean, because you really have to listen a whole record set, all those songs. You would have had to have listened to those things. If you were brand new to jazz, you would have to listen to them like every single day to really get that groove dialed into your head. So it was great for the people that had been listening to it their whole lives, but for the few people that were there that just wanted a survey of jazz and just kind of get the hang of it, It was brutal on them.
Mark, I'm having a flashback to the 35 millimeter slide deck too, that our history courses, first year. Parallel story, my daughter is in second year and had a Latin American culture course centered around music. And so they had a title, you know, studies of, you know, et cetera. And the sign up registration level was quite low. So they actually changed the name of the course, The Hips Don't Lie, and they maxed out enrollment and had a waiting list. And so there's a little thing about engagement, like maybe, you know, just changing up the language a little, you know, clearly took that class from, you know, something like the 20 mark, maybe to 70 or 80 or 100. I don't know what the size, but that was the backstory was that the name, they changed the name and suddenly the registrations went up. It's all about marketing, as Laura has said. Yeah. Or an engagement, which is sort of also, you know, a key thing that we're trying to bring forward here today in today's chat too. So.
Yep. And then the other thing that, oh yeah, I was just going to say the curse of knowledge is my favorite like phrase or sticker to put on this. Right. And I think academia is the perfect place to use the phrase because, to your point, Cara, people have studied and are so knee deep in their topic and they love it and they are passionate about it. And more often than not, they are one of the top experts in that field. And I think so many just forget what it's like to be, you know, brand new to a topic. And so when you get that extreme level of knowledge, trying to instruct a very basic level course, you need somebody like Cara North, an instructional designer, somebody to come in and say, whoa, you got to dial this back. These people don't know trombone from a saxophone.
Speaking of that, I saw a post on LinkedIn, which I'll have to dig it up and maybe drop the link here in a little bit. But there was a professor at a university, not this one, that has a 78-page syllabus and proud of it, calls it the monster syllabus. It's the famed. And looking through it, it's basically like an educational technology class, but the readings are enough reading to, in my mind, be the breadth of a PhD.
But is it good? Like what kind of feedback does he get at the end of the semester?
Well, going back to your point, Brent, this person is one of the pinnacle people in educational technology, and he's at all of the conferences. He's a keynoter. So, you know, I do think it's kind of a feather in the hat for the academic to say, oh, look at this wonderful piece of work that I've done for a syllabus. But I would be interested to see what their student survey data is. But that, again, is another kind of point that I think is a huge disconnect, I guess, between like the corporate L&D and then academia. I mean, this student survey data usually comes back 2 to 3 months after the course is finished.
Yeah.
Okay. So let's say you have a student that's really struggling, and the instructor has 200 to 300 students. They're not keeping tabs on them. And that person said, you know what? I really like this course, but the content wasn't the way that I needed it to be. I needed more remediation. I needed more resources to help me out. And it wasn't fitting my needs. And that student gets a bad score in that course. That student giving that feedback is not going to help that student because the grade's already there. They're not going to go back and change it. And then they may or may not make adjustments the next time it's offered. And who knows when it's offered again. I have some courses here as a student that are offered once every 2 years. And if I don't take it during that time, then, you know, it's going to delay my graduation. And I'm sure the same is true for undergraduate and master level students. So I will say, at least in corporate, I feel like if you get feedback, you can do something a little bit more with it than waiting. And the other thing, too, is it's on the preponderance of the instructor to do something with that feedback. The instructor is the one getting that feedback directly, not the design team. Whereas, obviously, in corporate, a lot of times it's the design team getting that feedback on the courses.
Yeah. And in the corporate space, too, you've got management and you've got the actual your performance on the job. You start to immediately see whether or not you're applying things correctly or, you know, and you've got that. You've got other people and other opportunities to apply feedback. And then of course there's that sort of continued performance support to kind of keep that knowledge embedded. So once you've gone to a class, say, even if it is instructor led in the corporate space, if it's, you know, you're taking it back to the job and you're using it every day, you know, there's that repetition involved. And if there's more, you know, if there's job aids available as well and all that kind of stuff, you're utilizing that knowledge all the time. So often you take a course at university, and even if it's something that you really enjoyed, as soon as the course is over, you may never talk about it ever again with anybody, you know, and then you just kind of forget it all because that's just the nature of how our brains work.
Yeah. And Dana threw in a note earlier, we were skimming through all kinds of things, but Dana did point out that there is much more to life than a utilitarian impact. So for, you know, a lot of places where you're just trying to gather knowledge, like learning even about, you know, jazz or English lit, which is what I did. You know, the intention in that was not to come out necessarily with directly serviceable skills in the sense of a trade or anything like that. But you're trying to understand the foundational stuff of something because you're interested and passionate in it. So, you know, not everything that we do in the L&D world, in the corporate world, is necessarily applicable, but still having some good goals is always important.
So, yeah. I mean, I don't want anybody, we should probably clarify that. I mean, obviously it's obviously sounding like there's a bias towards the corporate side of things, but Cara is in a PhD, so, and she's in that world and she loves it. And I found all of those courses that I took that I never really applied as my favorite. I remember taking Eastern Religions, which was a fantastic course to take. It was one of the most popular on campus at the time. It was all those courses that for me really enriched my higher ed experiences. And I didn't apply hardly any of those courses that I loved so much, but I loved it and I learned a lot, you know, and maybe subtly, subconsciously, we do apply that knowledge that we get in those courses, but just kind of in other ways that we're not even aware of. To her point, maybe, you know, we're gaining all of this knowledge and we're gaining all these different perspectives, and that's influencing the other things that we do, you know, and giving us a different view on things. So I'm a big fan of just the knowledge-based courses and the survey courses. Do not get me wrong. I find them to be fantastic. Like 5 years after I left, after I graduated, they announced that they had a history of rock and roll. And I'm like, how come they didn't have that when I was there? I had to take the jazz one. Come on.
We hadn't gotten old enough yet that we'd become history.
Right. Yeah. It wasn't academic enough, but now that rock and roll has a little bit more history, and there's somebody somewhere convinced the higher ups that that was a good idea. So I'd be curious to see if that course is still going strong. Yeah. But anyways, we don't want to run out of time too fast because we got one more thing we want to cover. And sorry to do the 180 on everybody, but Cara gave a great presentation and I want her to share it with you guys a little bit. The presentation she gave at TLDC 19 was just so well received, and she took a real risk doing it. It was the first time she'd done anything like it. And you just tell us a little bit about what gave you the idea and kind of just give us a little overview of what it was all about.
Sure. So a couple things that I've been researching as a student and then obviously as an instructional designer is the good old learner engagement. And if you go and just type in learner engagement in Google, you're going to get so many different responses and theories and paradigms and all kinds of information. And I thought, you know, there's got to be a better way. So I went to some literature, did some literature reviews of the term learner engagement, and a couple things stood out to me. One, there's no kind of uniform definition of what it is. And that really kind of bugged me. And I thought, well, maybe I shouldn't pursue this anymore. But then I kind of took inspiration from it being kind of a mystery. I was like, why does this have to be a mystery? Why is this such a mystery right now? And then it kind of hit me like, oh my gosh, like maybe I could make this kind of a mystery, make up this case where there's this learner that's disengaged. And I took inspiration from my friend Joe Suarez, who tells the story about when he was working at a particular company. He was walking the floor and he saw somebody asleep in front of his e-learning module. So I took a little creative liberties with that story and thought it would be really fun to present what the research says, unpack it a little bit, but do it in this way that is a mystery. So I created this character here called Sherlock Knowles, who obviously is named after Malcolm Knowles, the adult learning guy that has the coined the term andragogy and adult learning principles. So I took a little creative liberty there. Again, these were just like simple vectors that I got and put together. And the cool thing is, in the presentation, I thought it would be fun to like use him as kind of the person in the presentation. So I'm there kind of just running the technology, but the real star of the show is Detective Knowles. And I had this crazy idea to use like Poll Everywhere to talk to Detective Knowles. So I said, let's communicate from the great beyond. He can't be here. We're going to use Poll Everywhere to speak to him about it. So I have the information there. And then I thought, well, but you know, talking to this detective, that's no fun. Like, what else can I do? So then I came up with these three characters who are the sidekicks, because everybody was brand new to the mystery game. So you have the cat, Rufus, Tracy the dog, and Coco the monkey. And I had everybody pick who they wanted to be in the presentation. And so the slide after this actually is they vote. So everybody in the presentation votes, are you the cat, the dog, or the monkey that you want to work with? And these little bonuses here, not to give too much away, but depending on what team you picked, one, that'd be the team that you would work with in the case study after we reveal why the learners disengage. And two, the cunning, the speed, and the security has something to do with the scenario. So I'll spoil one of them, Rufus the cat in particular. You're basically like a newer instructional designer. The good standard of design at the place you're working at is not what you would think it would be. So not only do you have to basically lay out a plan of what learner engagement would look like in the new way of training, but because you have a cunning bonus, you have to sell it to your boss too. Because a lot of times that's what we have to do, right? If it's something different than what is the standard, you have to sell it to your boss. So that was kind of like the gist of the presentation.
Very cool. How long did it take you to put this together?
Once I had like the inspiration for the mystery, again, I just built this in Google Slides, and I'll share a little bit why I like to use Google Slides as opposed to other presentation software. But all in, I'd say writing the story, building the vectors, the resources, coming up with like the book or whatever, I don't know, maybe like a day or two.
Wow. That's fabulous. So much fun. Very cool.
Yeah, they did. So I'm curious, which character did the audience pick when you debuted this?
Great question. I think the majority was Team Rufus. And then I think Tracy was second and Coco was third. But the nice thing is at TLDC 19, we also did a live stream. And I see Q is here. Q was instrumental in making that happen. So when I think of the training, learning, development community, I think of that live stream because that's how I came into the community. And I knew people would be watching. I wanted to engage them too. So the cool part, and something I didn't even expect, is the people that were watching live also participated in these case studies too, were able to give feedback. And I remember in particular, the Coco the Monkey team said, hey, there were some ideas from the chat that are watching live. We want to incorporate those in our virtual Team Coco members. And I was just blown away by that.
That's awesome. I totally forgot about that. That's right. I did see some tweets go by of folks saying that they were enjoying watching the stream because they were playing along. And so would it be a spoiler if you told us who done it or why was the learner disengaged?
I don't know. I mean, I could go ahead and spoil it because I'll come up with just a new idea for the next time that I do it. So let me... So, oh, and one other thing real quick. I built this character who's like your stereotypical trainer that's done it the same way for 15 to 20 years. And I had a contest on Twitter for people to name him. So Joe Suarez named him Borson Welles. So that was his name for this presentation. So basically he's showing off that, you know, look how great my training looks, guys. Like, what's wrong with it? And, you know, Detective Knoll's like, no, that's not the best way to do it. So after you kind of go through the mysteries here, so what's the verdict? He's in a slumber because he took too many bullets from PowerPoint.
Oh, nice.
I love it. That is fantastic. So you mentioned some technologies, and I do want to ask you to share this with us too, because I do remember people saying how cool they thought it was. So you mentioned Poll Everywhere that you used. I think most people know what that is, but tell us again why you like to use Google Slides.
How about instead of just telling, I'll show. One thing that I love about Google Slides is it does live automatic captioning. And of course, it's going to make a liar out of me. No, there we go. So it captions in live time, which is fantastic if you're doing a presentation. I oftentimes when I get excited, I speak fast and I know that, but being able to have captioning going in case I say something quickly or if my Southern accent comes out a little bit, that way people can catch up on it. Now, there's a couple words that I wish it would do better on. For example, my name, I say Cara North. And it usually gives them, oh, it did at that time. It's learning. It's great. Yeah. So I know at TLDC 19, my name was Karen Horse is what it came up as in the captioning. But I really think that this is a great way to, again, just have an extra piece going. Again, you never know if somebody might have to check something on their phone or, you know, I don't believe everybody should have undivided attention anytime you speak. So having the captioning there, I think captures something a little bit more. From now on, ever since they launched this in October, any presentation that I do at conferences, I'll always use live captioning.
I think you can do that in PowerPoint too.
You can, but there are some caveats to that. It does not work on a Mac, my friend, and I have a Mac.
Okay, then.
Yeah.
Only Windows, right?
Yeah, for now. They may be coming out with something soon, but currently it's PC only.
And I'm assuming Keynote doesn't do it?
You know, I'm not a big Keynote user. I just like Google Slides just because it's easy, cloud-based, you know, super easy to use. So that's just kind of my go-to, but I don't want to speak about Keynote because I'm not sure.
Yeah. No, I'll look into it afterwards because I think that's amazing. People were blown away when they saw it. They're like, Cara North is doing live closed captioning. It's amazing.
And I thought it was good to have for the live stream audience as well, because again, depending on where you're watching it at, you may or may not have audio or, you know, something might disrupt you. So having that for them was also super important to me. And the last thing that I did during the presentation is I live tweeted myself during the presentation. So I had all my tweets lined up to go out about the presentation in case somebody could not tune in and they wanted to follow me to get the gist of what I was talking about, they could at least follow my own tweets on Twitter.
Very cool. Nice. Very cool. I do know that you can trigger tweets based on slides. So like as you go to the next slide, I don't know if it's an if this, then that statement or I can't remember, but we were doing this a while back and setting up tweets to launch as every slide would go. So that's been around for a while, but I can't remember how we used to do that.
That's cool. I just basically time it out in buffer when I think I'm going to be at the 5-minute mark, send this, 10-minute mark, this. I like that. I'll have to look into the if this and that. I didn't know that.
Yeah, you can trigger it. But the only thing you have to be careful of is you have to make sure that that's the very last thing you set up. Because if you start testing it and practicing, then all of a sudden all those tweets are going to start to go out. So you have to make sure you have all your timing right and all of that. But this is so cool. Was there any other tech? I forgot. So we did Poll Everywhere. You got the closed captioning using Google Docs.
No, those were really the big ones. Actually, speaking of Google Docs real quick, let me go to that. So I made case studies for each of the teams here. And essentially, I'll just open one up real quick. I'll have to share a different tab, or maybe I'll just put it here in the chat so you guys can go to it. But it's just basically a Google Doc with the case study in it that people can go through. And I said, you know, share this with your team. If your team's not here and you want to have this as like a calibration exercise or something, that'd be cool. But after they did it, I actually had the teams in the case studies make their own slides about it. And I had them present their solutions in my presentation, because nobody wants to hear me talk the whole time. And then if you go down and click on that, I gave each team three slides, and I denoted their slides by using their character's picture in the corner there, so they could see like where the team Rufus, team Tracy, and team Coco, where they would have to add their information in.
Very cool.
That is so cool. Did anybody get the answer right?
Yeah. I mean, they were written in a way where there was no absolute right or wrong answer. The word "it depends," you know, yeah, works for a lot of it. But I have to say, I was really, a couple things I was blown away on overall is the dog one. If you selected Team Tracy, you were a new manager of a instructional design team that had been promoted within. So these people not necessarily have any training in learning development, but they have moved up in the company and then got a promotion. And that's something near and dear to my heart, because that's how I got involved in instructional design myself, moving up the ranks at Amazon. But they really focused on positivity of that this team would have product knowledge out the wazoo. You wouldn't have to really share kind of the knowledge of the company with them. They could really hit the ground running for upskill, which I thought was a really nice observation I hadn't really thought much about. And the Team Coco, that case study was about you work in a security environment and they don't want a lot of things, you know, linking out to technology and all that. And they had some really cool ideas about breaking out, like breakout rooms in the training. And they came up with some really neat ideas. And I want to say it was Keith Stoneman and Alan Nodichu, I think, were the two main people. And Gene Maripati was also in Team Coco, if I remember right. And they really worked well together and really came up with some neat things. So if you actually go to that link and scroll down and click on the slides, you can actually see the slides of the, actually, you know what, I can stop sharing this and share that real quick. You can see what they built with it, which is pretty nifty.
Yeah, and we still need to get to our coffee mug giveaway. I keep forgetting too, so I don't. And we like to go a little bit shorter than the hour, so we're kind of pushing up against the time clock here.
Yeah. So, Cara, why don't you pull that up and show us that bit? And in the meantime, we'll get set here anyway. So just take 1 minute when you get that, if you can, Cara, and then we'll flip over to the draw for the big valuable prize set.
Whoops, wrong tab. Give me a second here.
Yeah.
Okay, here we go. Hey, can you guys see this?
There we go. Yep.
Okay. So yeah, so here's basically what Team Rufus put together, which was great. Team Tracy, they, because they had a speed bonus, they had less time than the other teams. So they had 8 minutes as opposed to 10. And here's what Team Coco did with the bank stuff, which was really, really well done. They did a really nice job. All teams did. I was just blown away by what they came up with.
Yeah. Very nice.
That's very cool. Neato. Well, thank you so much for sharing that with us, Cara. That's absolutely, that's so cool. And I think anybody who's in our group here who wasn't there is now thinking, gosh, I wish I was there at the time to have experienced it firsthand. Yeah. Awesome job. Very cool. Let's do our draw quick before we start losing folks. I'm seeing a little bit of a trickle out. Brent, we have 19 people in total in attendance here today. Let's pick a number. You're going to handle the number, right?
Yeah, I'm going to handle the number, and we're going to do this the Alexa way. Alexa, give me a random number between 1 and 19.
Your random number between 1 and 19 is 10.
All right. Now I have to count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. It is Cheryl Habgood is the first winner. So Cheryl, we will try to figure out how to get a hold of you and figure out where to send the mug. So maybe stay on and we can negotiate that. Maybe just enough details, you know, to connect with Cheryl without, you know, revealing everything.
We've got her email because she's signed in.
Oh, so right. I forget that there's a tool here involved. Cheryl, you're the first winner. All right, Brent, give us one more. We've got a pair to give away today. We're making two happy people.
A random number between 1 and 19.
Your random number between 1 and 19 is 6.
6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It's Laura S.
Laura Sanchez.
There we go. Woo-hoo. Awesome. And poor Q, he's been jonesing for a cup for the last few episodes. Truth be told, I was hoping that Alexa would come through for Q on this one.
Sorry, Q. I can bring you my chipped one if you want.
Very cool. Very, very, very cool.
So. Yeah, that's fun. All right, you guys. It's been a year. Holy smokes. What do we got planned for the new year?
More of the same, but only better.
Only better. It just keeps getting better and better and better. You know what we would like to ask for, though, is some feedback from everybody. If there's people you'd like to hear us talk to or invite to the show as guests, you know, you guys.
Topic areas?
Yeah. Topics you want us to discuss or anything like that. Let us know what you're interested in and what you want to talk about. And we can make
that happen. Lots of ways to do that. Grab us, use the idiotic hashtag in Twitter. Probably most of you have emails for either Brent or I anyway, too. So it'd be, great ways to hear about these things. So, Dana, these are always, the sessions are always recorded. They're saved here in Crowdcast, so you can come back later and review them here. We also post them to our YouTube channel, and we also post them both to iTunes, Google Play, Spotify as audio podcasts. So there's lots of ways to catch up on these if you can't make it on a Wednesday.
The easiest thing to remember is just idiotic.com, because that has all the links to everything. You can get to iTunes from there. You can scroll all the way down to the bottom, and there will be the whole list of links to go take you to Crowdcast if you want to, you know, watch the chat and watch this recording specifically. But the iTunes is there. All the YouTube stuff, all anything that you need for Idiotic, you can just go to idiotic.com.
Very cool. Brent? Let's play some music and dance.
I believe that means that that is the end of our show today. Thank you so much, Cara North, for hanging out with us and talking
to us.
Thanks, Cara. What a great conversation.